gym, set screens, you can have a really nice NBA career.
Yes, you can, and that requires a lot of energy.
Yes.
And that's what Montrezl Harrell brings every night. It is a talent to bring energy and hard work to the floor every night. That's what puts him in position a lot of times to make the positive plays he makes.
Got a couple of block shots to go with those 14 points, a couple of rebounds as well. And he leads with 14 off what has been the most productive bench in the NBA. Lou Williams obviously has a lot to do with that.
Yeah, the way that they play the game, I think, also allows for their bench to be productive. They're doing it by committee this year without one of those first ballot all NBA guys.
Right.
So the ball is always moving. Guys are cutting, and they play a good style of basketball under Doc Rivers. Allows Lou Williams and Montrez to get buckets every night.
Clippers have only turned it over three times. Luka Doncic has turned it over five on his own. Otherwise, he is not disappointed. 13 points to go with five boards and six assists. Guess what happened tonight that hasn't happened since the 9th of December? It involves that guy in a win, no less. The MVP back in the lineup tonight for the Houston Rockets with the Hawks in town. Remember, he sat out Saturday night in the Rockets' win in Oakland. And remember, he's got that 30-point streak, 32 straight games and counting as he goes to work on the Hawks. High off the glass there, then comes down, scores in the paint. 13 points on just 2 of 10 shooting early on. Trae Young, career night for him. That was a wild three-pointer. Here comes Chris Paul. He'll take that. He had 20 on the night. Houston up by 11. Hawks very much in this thing. John Collins. And then Trae Young had the feeling. He often has the feeling. He doesn't always have the touch, but he has the feeling.
It's true. Plays with a lot of confidence.
Game tied at 60 at the half, third quarter. Rockets take off here a little bit. Harden in for the floater, and then Kenneth Faried. What a great find he has been. And Eric Gordon knew where to find him. 13 points, 10 boards for Faried. Young, career high, 8 threes in this game. He goes for 36.
I tell you what, they used to call ATL A-Town. Trae Young liked H-Town with the 8 threes tonight.
Ice Trae going for 36 and keeping Atlanta in the game. 107-102 at that point. Paul to Gordon. Easy. He had 16. Okay, so here's where it gets dramatic. Late in the fourth, remember, Harden still got this 30-point threshold to meet. Sitting on 23 with less than 2 minutes to go. Pulls up for the three, but is fouled. He would make all three free throws by my math. That gives him 26. Harden drives in for the floater. That gives him 28. Hawks come down and score. It's Dwayne Dedmon with the dunk with 10 seconds left. Game is decided. What do you do?
I think he does the right thing, man.
I think so, too.
Yeah.
It's tempting.
I'm sure.
Because he knew, and obviously the Hawks knew. You see a couple of them come up to greet him there across the line. And so the 30-point streak ends at 32 straight games, second longest in NBA history. First time since December 11th, not December 9th, correcting myself, that he did not score at least 30 in a game. That's a long time.
That is a very long time, man. Hats off to the beard.
Lakers coming off the loss in New Orleans Saturday night. In Memphis tonight, LeBron James, a little history for him as he passes Andre Miller to move into 10th on the all-time assists list. Shout out to the professor, by the way, Andre Miller. James, the fadeaway in the paint. Happy 34th birthday to Joakim Noah, who played great tonight for the Memphis Grizzlies. Dunking on JaVale McGee, looking spry at 34, like a whole new guy. Here's Brandon Ingram, 19 at the half for him. And then Avery Bradley, a little under the rim action.
Yeah, yeah. You know, stepped on the shoe a little bit, you know, a little sneaky little step.
Hey, if you can get it in, nobody notices. It works. 61-56, Memphis on top at the half. Second half, Grizzlies in transition now. It's Mike Conley. He had a big night. And then DeJuan Wright to Noah, 14-12 off the Memphis bench. Memphis up by 8. Ingram, corner three, went for 32 tonight. Conley drives, loves that right-hand floater. He had 30, 12 of them in the fourth quarter. Getting late for the Lakers. James picks up the triple-double here on the assist and records his 79th career triple-double. That moves him past Will Chamberlain for fifth all-time, but we got a game to play here, Fish. James drives, spins, lays it home, and one. And the Lakers are within two, but LeBron had an air ball late and then an offensive foul late. What do you think?
I mean, initially I thought it was a little bit of a questionable call, but Joakim Noah was right there, took the bump, which is not easy to do versus LeBron.
No, it is not. So the Lakers are now just 3-5 since James returned to the lineup following that long stretch out with the groin injury. Here's the King after another loss.
Just stay positive, and that's, you know, starts with me. Just got to stay positive, keep knocking on the door, you know. And I feel like if we play like we did tonight, then we got to continue that consistent effort. You know, we'll get us over the hump as we make this push. So, you know, this is a tough loss. Obviously, I'm replaying plays throughout my mind right now. It's tough, but just stay positive and just keep watching the film. Obviously, we're not going to have much on the court practice time because we're playing every other day this week. But you know, the film session is going to be very key, and how well you can take care. You got to take care of your body starting tonight because the games are coming. That's what it's about. At this point, if you are still allowing distractions to affect you, the way you play, then this is the wrong franchise to be a part of, and you should just come and be like, listen, I can't do this. Like, seriously, if you're distracted by playoff pushes and then and all the stuff that's been talked about this year, just come and do your job. We do our job at a high level, and you know, that's not a distraction. That's what you want. That's what you want every game. You want to feel like you're fighting for something.
LeBron James challenging the teammates. Lakers are now 3.5 back of the Clippers for the moment, depending on whether LA can hang on in the second half. James Harden back in the lineup tonight for the Houston Rockets. Sitting on 28 points, Dwayne Dedman gets the dunk for the Hawks here. Game is effectively over, but Harden's got 28 points and a 30-point scoring streak sitting at 32 games. Is he going to take the shot, Fish? No, he's not. And look, the Hawks come over to double-team him. No, you're not getting that up. Sorry. Congratulations for him, but the streak ends at 32. The first time since the 9th of December he hasn't scored 30 in an NBA game.
Since last year. It feels that long too, right?
That's another way of looking at it. Houston gets the win at home, 119-111. He did have 28 points, although he was 0 of 10 from three-point range. Lakers' troubles continue. After the loss in New Orleans, they headed to Memphis and couldn't deal with Mike Conley. Conley, 10 of 17 from the field. He knocked down three threes in six attempts, 30 points on the night to go with five assists as Memphis beats the Lakers 110-105. So, Fish, your Lakers have now lost 6 of 8. They are 3-5 since LeBron returned to the lineup despite his triple-double tonight.
Yeah, you know what, Matt? When I used to play for the Lakers, we couldn't guard Mike Conley, and I used to get a lot of that blame. It turns out Mike Conley's pretty darn good.
Mike Conley's a good player.
Doesn't matter who's playing for the Lakers, he can get 30.
So no progress in terms of the eighth spot in the playoff race, which is occupied currently by the LA Clippers, who we're about to see tonight against the Dallas Mavericks.
Yeah, no, an opportunity for sure for the Clippers. After dropping one in Denver last night, Lakers lose in Memphis. Clippers get a chance to squeeze one out at home and stay in that eighth spot.
They didn't just drop one. They lost by 27 last night in Denver. That's not exactly dropping one. Mavericks have lost four in a row, but they get Luka Doncic back tonight.
That always helps. Whether you've lost four or won four, Luka Doncic on the court is a positive for the Dallas Mavericks.
The prohibitive rookie of the year favorite has been amazing so far this season for Dallas. Nearly 21 a game, 7 boards, 5.5 assists or so. Tip coming up from L.A. Let's send it upstairs. Casey, Smitty, and Brendan.
All right, Matt, thank you very much. Game one, great finish. Mm-hmm. See what we have in game two. We know we've got Luka the Don. How do you not love what he's done? So crafty, so creative, and so 19. Unbelievable the poise he's got at that age.
Yeah, when you watch Luka play, he plays like he's been here before. He's a rookie that plays like a veteran. He's great in the pick and roll. His confidence in his shot has continued to grow. And the biggest thing about him that I like is you can never speed him up. He always plays at his own tempo, his own pace. And that's something that a lot of young guys have to learn. Luka comes into the game with that already.
And I was going to say, you want to watch this game if you haven't seen him play. Brought a few things out of the bag the last time that we saw him a couple of weeks ago. He's gotten a lot of attention. Some of the most improved players like Siakam have, who hasn't, 24 years old. How about Montrezl Harrell and what he's done and the growth from 1 year to the next for the Clippers?
You know, Case, I'm glad we're bringing up. This is a kid who puts on his hard hat, B-Wood, comes out undersized center but plays extremely hard. And you see him and watched him his whole career at Louisville. Then when he first entered this league, he's always played this hard. But now you're starting to look at the points. He has 918 points. That's third in the NBA coming off the bench. He had 30 points in 14 minutes against the Memphis Grizzlies. He's third with 13 double-doubles off the bench. He's kind of their finisher, their closer for the Clippers. I love what this kid has transformed into. Still a hard worker. Hasn't forgot his foundation, B-Wood, but he's added some offense, and they're trusting him off on the offensive end.
Two things for those who haven't watched the Clippers. One, they'll always have bench points against you because you got Harrell and Lou Will. The other thing is, when Gallo is healthy, they're a different team. And I think everybody talked about, B-Wood, the contract so often. But when he's there, there are so many things he does and space he creates to help others on the floor. We've seen that lately.
Well, Gallo's like what I like to call a movable chess piece. You can put him all over the board, and he can give you a different type of option. The fact that he can play that four, that five for you, he can be on the perimeter and take fives away from the basket. But at the same time, when you try to switch and put smaller players on him, Gallo's good enough to get points on the box. So Gallo does a lot of different things and causes a lot of matchup problems.
Yeah, look in New Orleans, where the Sixers and Pelicans will tip it shortly. Philly comes in fourth in the Eastern Conference. Pelicans are 12th and six games out of the eighth and final playoff spot in the Western Conference. I asked the guys the other day if they are still in the playoff race, and they just said no, they're not. Sorry.
They made it very clear.
They didn't even give them a fighting chance.
Check Diallo.
Exactly, like check Diallo. No, they're not. they're just not. Time for the keys to the game presented by AutoZone. What you got?
Well, in my opinion, for the Sixers, clearly attacking the boards has to be at the top of the list. Blazers killed them, and no Embiid again tonight with Davis, Diallo, Okafor up front. That'll be key. Shooting and making threes. Embiid is a floor spacer, even though he doesn't shoot a lot of threes. They'll need to make those tonight. And then transition defense, we know as we turn the page to New Orleans, playing with pace is one of their keys. The Sixers will have to get back. Guarding the three-point line for New Orleans will be a key tonight. Redick, 1-for-10. He's going to shoot better. Get him off the three-point line. Play fast, and then protect the paint. Without Embiid, you cannot allow Simmons to live in the paint. And we want to see a Jimmy Butler sighting as well.
Right. Very quiet in the second half.
He has been quiet, but protecting your paint will be key.
Sixers won the first meeting back in Philadelphia, 121-120. J.J. Redick was 0-of-7 from three-point range in that game. So as Griff likes to say, reverting to the mean, you would expect him to play better tonight and knock down some shots.
We would expect him to play better tonight, but when you start to think about Etuan Moore and Jrue Holiday, these guys are long-arm guard defenders, 6'3", 6'4". They cover the ball well. They can close out to the body. And Jrue Holiday and Etuan Moore, great shot contesters. So I'm not surprised that Redick has struggled, but we do expect him to shoot the ball a little better than he did on Saturday, as well as the last time these two teams faced.
Jimmy Butler has scored less than 20 in four of his last five games, and we talked about how quiet he was on Saturday. How do they get him going early?
Well, Brett Brown will probably have to be intentional about getting the basketball to Butler. The ball sticks at times when it touches Jimmy Butler's hands. It's not typically how the Sixers like to play with ball movement and player movement. But early, just to get him going, they might have to get him some touches.
Ben Simmons, big numbers the last couple of games, but they're clearly missing Joel Embiid. We'll see how the Pelicans try to take advantage of that. See if Philly can gang rebound and close that gap. They were out rebounded by 20 the other night against the Portland Trailblazers. And we'll see the game play out from New Orleans. And to do that, we send it upstairs to the game lounge with Casey, Smitty, and Brendan.
All right, Matt, thank you very much. Fish, we'll see you guys at halftime. We've got a great double dip, beginning with two teams in very different directions. Smitty, and it was a trade I wasn't, you know, happy with, but a couple of first-round picks, too. We got B-Wood in for this week for Candace. When we look at the moves that have been made, the big three went to the big four. Tobias Harris been a big difference. Why?
Well, I think what I love about Tobias Harris' game, it travels, and he can play with anybody. He was the number one option, in my opinion, in L.A., averaging about 20 points. Well, he's the second or maybe the third option, however where you want to put him. He's still averaging 19 points, but he's shooting better from the field, 53%. And they look well with him. He has not disrupted his offense. He hasn't taken away from Ben Simmons. He hasn't taken away from Joel Embiid. But the one thing is, B, what I would ask you, what does it do for Jimmy Butler? You see his usage rates has gone extremely down since Harris has joined the 76ers.
Well, what it does for Jimmy Butler, it takes away the ball out of his hands, obviously. Some nights now, he's the third to fourth option. This is a guy that in Chicago, towards the end of his stint there, he was the first option. He was the first option in Minnesota. And now he comes to Philadelphia, and he had to learn how to be the second or third option. Now he's learned how to be the third or the fourth option. To his credit, since Tobias has been there, we haven't really heard much from Jimmy, but he's used to getting his ball in certain areas, certain spots, getting his ISOs and getting a chance to do certain things that now he doesn't have the opportunity to do when they have their big four out there. But the good news is he'll be able to win more. His usage rate is going down, but his winning percentage is going to go up because he's playing with a really talented ball club. He just has to make sure he keeps his eyes on the prize and focus on winning.
Well, the eyes were on the tweets from Nurkic and some of the comments that were made about Ben's shooting. Just keep everybody kind of privy. 3.5 hours before tip tonight.
Is he shooting with jeans and a belt on?
And jeans and a belt.
They didn't have any warm-up gear for him that early.
You know, B-Wood, I wish we could pan down and see what shoes he's wearing.
He didn't even change.
I was wondering if he wearing some riding shoes.
What is going on here?
Hey, this is the new league. You played in the new league.
No, I didn't play in that new league. Guys at least got changed before they went on the court.
You know, he's got great.
He came straight from the car.
Great shoes and tough to fill his shoes. In the film room throughout the course of game night Monday, every Monday, both of our games tonight, not only our architect, but also taking us through numbers and looking at the game in a different way. So happy to have Griff with us, David Griffin. Griff, when you look at this Sixers offense and you think about Ben and Butler and Embiid, who I know not there tonight, and Tobias Harris, who Smitty talked about, quite a group here in this starting five.
Yeah, remarkable talent that they have. Tobias and Jimmy, obviously, the newest additions. And I think what really strikes me about this matchup tonight, the process was sort of hatched, as it were, with the trade of Drew Holiday from Philadelphia to the Pelicans. And when Drew was traded there for the pick that was Nerlens Noel and a future first that became Elfrid Payton, ironically, who will also be in this game, it really set in motion everything that enabled Philadelphia to build their roster in the way they did. You saw that New Orleans has actually been more successful in the short term because of this man, Drew Holiday. He is a dominant two-way guard, can make plays for other people, defends at an extremely high level. He and Anthony Davis are a lethal duo. You've seen Drew play his best basketball in the most important games that they play in. And what's really fascinating now about where they find themselves because of Anthony Davis and because of the situation looming over them with this potential trade, do they go the way of the process and move away completely from Drew, or can they recapture enough from an asset standpoint in an Anthony Davis trade to make building around Drew Holiday continue to make sense, because he's a special player and they're in a difficult position there.
Griff, I want you to put your GM hat on. When you look at Drew Holiday, he's did everything you've asked for him. I don't think he gets enough credit. He all defensive team. When you start talking about a guy defending, then he's a guy who took the ball out of his hand with Rondo. Why aren't too many teams going after Drew Holiday to make a trade for this type of guy to get them over the hump?
Well, I have the feeling they will, and I think it's going to be really interesting to see which direction New Orleans takes. So many people, and again, the process is a lot of the reason, and the rhetoric around the process is a lot of the reason for this. People think of team building as being totally binary. Either you're a threat to win a title, or you should be trying to get draft picks. And what's really interesting is New Orleans has put a lot of value in competing at a high level for their marketplace, putting an incredibly entertaining product on the floor, and Drew Holiday is a huge part of that. So you can't just say blindly, okay, well, if you're not going to have AD, you move Drew too, because if you get enough back in an Anthony